request for another true crime video. So I went online, and because I never have time to research certain cases or anything like that, because I'm always working. Just get started, shall we? Make sure my hair is on point. My teeth are not really on point either, so I'll try to keep my mouth closed. So I'll be looking at the computer screen right in front of me. I won't be looking at the camera, so hopefully that doesn't bother you guys. So let's see. Okay, the 50 strangest unsolved mysteries. Number one is the body on Somerton Beach. In December 1948, a body was found on Somerton Beach in Adelaide, Australia. The body was a man who was dressed impeccably in a suit with polished shoes. In his head slumped against a wall. Authorities thought the case of death was heart failure, but more likely poisoning. However, during the autopsy, no trace of poison was found. There wasn't a wallet or any type of identification on the man, and all the tags in his clothing were cut out. The fingerprints that the authorities took of him were also unidentifiable. They even put a photo of the body in the newspapers, and still no one could identify who the man was. 4 months after the body was found, detectives found a hidden pocket that was sewn on the inside of his trousers. Inside the pocket was a rolled up piece of paper from a rare book called the Rubaiyat. The piece of paper had the words "Tamam Shud," probably butchering these words, on it, which means "it is ended." After months of looking for the exact book, authorities decide to bury the Somerton man without identification. Although a cast was taken at the bust and he was embalmed to preserve him, 8 months later, a man walked into the police station. I was found by John, and duct tape was found across her mouth and a smooth cord around her neck. When police arrived, it was suspected that the crime scene was heavily compromised due to multiple people arriving at the scene. The police had also claimed that they had not searched the house after Patsy's initial call because there was no reason to believe that JonBenet was in the house. At the time of her death, JonBenet was known as a child beauty queen superstar, having won at least 5 high-end child beauty competitions. Her death was ultimately ruled a homicide. The autopsy stated that JonBenet's official cause of death was by strangulation associated with cranial trauma. Due to JonBenet's beauty queen popularity and her mother being a former beauty queen, the case caused nationwide immediate interest. Today, the crime is still unsolved and remains an open investigation with the Boulder Police Department. Now, what I believe about this case is when they did her autopsy, they found pineapple in her stomach, right? And they also found the pineapple on the table. So what I think is her brother did it. Maybe it was an accident. And her mother and father, or preferably her mother, covered it up so that Burke wouldn't get in trouble for killing her. That's what I feel like happened. But we'll never know, unfortunately, unless somebody comes forward and says I did it. So, I've never heard this one before. Number 9, Chicago Tylenol Murders. On September 29th, 1982, 7 people in the Chicago area ingested poison Tylenol pills, consequently collapsing and dying shortly after. The 7 victims included 12-year-old Mary Kellerman, 27-year-old Mary Reiner, 31-year-old Mary McFarland, 35-year-old Paula Prince, 27-year-old Adam Janus, 25-year-old Stanley Janus, and 19-year-old Teresa Janus. Adam Janus ingested a Tylenol and died at the hospital. When the family came back to mourn, Stanley Janus and his wife Teresa took a Tylenol and died, making it 3 deaths in the same family on the same day. However, this tragedy is what led investigators to connect the dots. Cook County investigator Nick Pichos compared the Janus's Tylenol bottle to Mary Kellerman's and noticed they had one similarity, a control number MC2880. Deputy medical examiner Edmund Donoghue asked Pichos to smell the bottles, and Pichos replied that they both smelled like almonds. The poison cyanide is known to smell like bitter almonds, which in large amounts can cause seizures, cardiac arrest, and respiratory failure. The blood test on all the victims showed that they had taken a dose 100 to 1,000 times the lethal amount. Donoghue spoke to an attorney from Johnson & Johnson, Tylenol's parent company, and after all the victims were buried on October 1st, 1982, that the Tylenol bottles were initially poisoned with potassium cyanide. Immediately, over 31 million bottles These precautions cost the company over $100 million. There were several more copycat deaths across the United States after the initial incident had occurred. This led to the invention of safety seals that you use on medicine bottles today. To this day, no suspect has ever been charged or convicted of the poisonings. Wow. Okay. Oh. Okay. Speaking of celebrities, the mysterious death of Tupac Shakur. On September 7th, 1996, at the MGM Grand Casino in Las Vegas, Nevada, well-known rapper Tupac Shakur was seen attending a Mike Tyson boxing match. After the match, Tupac left with the CEO of Death Row Records, Suge Knight. Upon the departure of the match, Tupac and his bodyguards got into a fight with Compton-based Southside Crips gang member Orlando Anderson in the lobby of the EGM. After the fight was broken up, Tupac and Knight left in Knight's car with Tupac's entourage following and cars behind them. While stopped at the intersection of Flamingo and Koval, a white Cadillac pulled up to the passenger side of Knight's car and shot out of the window, hitting Tupac four times and grazing Knight in the head with a bullet fragment. In 2014, retired LVPD Sergeant Chris Carroll revealed that he was the first police officer at the scene. According to Carroll, when he opened the car door, Tupac fell out of the car, covered in blood, and Carroll asked, "Who shot you?" Tupac took a deep breath and only proclaimed explicative words at the police officer before slipping into unconsciousness. Tupac was taken to UMC and placed on life support and into a medically induced coma. On September 13, 1996, 6 days after the shooting, Tupac died as a result of his injuries at the age of 25. Las Vegas police never arrested anyone in connection with the murder. They also failed to follow up with Yaki Gaddafi, I probably said that wrong, a member of Tupac's entourage who claimed he could identify the assailant. Unfortunately, Gaddafi was murdered only 2 months after the infamous shooting, before he could be interviewed. To this day, no one has been claimed a suspect and no arrests have been made. Virginia, which is from where I'm from, so let's end on this one. On the night, it's called the Soder Children Disappearance. On the night before Christmas in 1945 in Fayetteville, West Virginia, George and Jeannie Soder were asleep with 9 other children when a fire started in the house around 1 in the morning. George, Jeannie, and 4 of their children managed to escape. The remaining children, 14-year-old Maurice, 12-year-old Martha, 9-year-old Louis, 8-year-old Jeannie, and 5-year-old Betty, still remained in the company went outside to retrieve his ladder. It was missing from its normal spot. Plus, both of his coal trucks, which he was going to use to stand on top of, were strangely not starting. Marion, one of the children who escaped the fire, ran to a neighbor's house to phone the fire department, but the operator didn't pick up. When another neighbor called, the operator failed to pick up the phone again. That same neighbor actually drove to town and found the fire chief in person, F.J. Morris, and told him about the fire. However, even though the fire station was located a mere 2.5 miles away from the house, the firefighters didn't reach the Sodar home until 8 a.m., 7 hours after the fire began. When they got there, the house was literally burnt to ash. Authorities sifted through the ash to try and find the remains of the missing 5 children, but nothing was found, and they were presumed dead due to the fire. Morris suggested that the fire was so hot that it literally cremated the children's bodies, including their bones. While that theory sounds reasonable, it's not entirely accurate, because even when flesh is burned away, bones are typically left behind. Additionally, there was no smell of burning flesh reported during or after the fire. The cause of the fire was deemed to be bad wiring, and the 5 missing children were issued death certificates. Soon after the fire, George and Jeannie began to suspect that their children were not dead, but instead kidnapped, and the fire was deliberately set as a diversion. In fact, George had the wiring checked earlier that fall by the power company, which had deemed